Well, we had welcome to our service this morning at 11 o'clock at Burford. It's great to have you with us. Welcome to you if you're here with us in the building or if you're online. Great to have you with us and tuning in. We are indeed one in the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd like the choir with us today. You won't have seen them on the screen, but they are down there and they're going to be helping us with our praise later on. Very grateful to them. And I know they're delighted to be back and singing as well. Well, we are going to begin our service with praise. Let us stand, therefore, and say our opening prayer together as we reflect on the greatness of God, and then we'll sit for the hymn. Let us praise God together in these words. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Everything we see reminds us of your power and glory, because you made everything out of nothing. You made the sun and the moon. You made the land and the sea. You made the birds and the fish and all the animals. And you made us to love you and take care of your creation. We praise you for all your gifts and for helping us take care of all the world. Thank you for your creativity and your love. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Amen. We say to all the musicians and bodies.
Says, my people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of
current systems that are cracked and dry. And it's we forsaken the hope at Almighty God, the one who created all things, and we've instead found our own way, tried to find our own way and see things on our own. And that is like digging cracked and dry systems, going for the sort of sludge at the bottom, rather than the fresh and pure and the life water that the Lord Jesus offers. So it's right that we seek to restore that relationship with God through the Lord Jesus Christ as we confess our sins together. A moment of quiet before we pray. Together we pray. Merciful God, you pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbour as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you, our God. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness. In your great compassion, cleanse us from our sin. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore us to the glory of your salvation, and sustain us with your bountiful Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The prophet Isaiah reminds us that surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Precious Father, we thank you how the Lord Jesus Christ takes our sin on himself, that we might have our sins forgiven and our relationship to you restored. Just a couple of verses at this point. And the first to say that the opportunity to pray for Burford, Tom knows at the back, but it's every Monday, so even though it says it was last Monday, it's also this Monday. So do please join us if you'd like to pray particularly for Burford, and that's on Monday at 6:30 on Zoom. There's also no staff at APCM, the annual Burford Church meeting, usually it has to be done by the end of April, and now it has to be done by the end of November, because of COVID. And it's an opportunity for us to reflect on the year ending the 31st of December, so quite a while ago, but also to give thanks and to look forward, but also to elect new members of the PCC and new boards. Do please join us. Two elections from electoral roll, that is open still, that closes today, and therefore if you want to know electoral roll, you need to sign up for that. If you want to know what an electoral roll is, you can talk to me afterwards, and we'll find someone who understands it, and we can get you on. Now we also say that we're delighted that our children and young people continue to meet over in the Warwick Hall, and we do need a couple of extra helpers, particularly with the sixth forms group, sometimes it's also just to be a legal body. And so if you are a legal body, if you are available and able to do that, we'd very much appreciate your help. And if you get, if you'd like to, willing to help us out with that, do please speak to me afterwards. That would be much help as we seek to teach and encourage our young people in these tricky times. Please find your help. Well, before we come to the intercessions, which Tim Vickers is going to leave for us at the praise collection today. And so we pray. O Lord, we beseech you mercifully to hear the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may both perceive and know what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to fulfill them. through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the church, we thank you for the body of Christ, the global body of Christ. We thank you for its amazing cultural and ethnic diversity. We pray you help us in this little sleepy corner of the edge of the continent to know that we are part of the most cosmopolitan Heavenly Father, conscious of the history of the church in Ephesus, that Paul is writing to discover something. But by the time John was writing in Revelation, they lost their first love. And by the time we get to the present day, the city of the Holy Ephesus, the church of the Holy Ephesus, and Turkey is a country which is difficult to live in. We recognize that that history could be our history too. As we see secularism strive to push Christianity to merge into our nation. And we pray that please find a place in new church congregations up and down our country with us people, so the eyes are open. And we might see that the virtue is the power of the living God, and we might not do this stuff as well. But we pray for Turkey. We pray for Syria. These two countries which seem on the margin of potential catastrophe or unclear. We pray for tiny pockets of relief. We pray that the very grace of the very least people in spirit will feel that they are in fellowship with sisters and brothers and other people who are holding up to you. And we pray that we continue to inspire them with wonderful words committed to the most glorious and to their country. Well, we thank you for the logic behind the use of the growth of the church in places where it should happen. All the way across the Middle East and North Africa. We think of Christians who fear the possibility of potential loss of life. Because we're looking at the approach that we will be in fellowship with. Through prayer, intercede, and we will watch out. I want to bring you to meeting them. And your presence is alone, I suppose. But we pray also that we will take courage from their example and that we will be bold. And we will not be complacent as we feel that it's happening. We will pray how to speak out to you, how to bring you into conversation, and let your words be in heaven. Father, we pray for our own country, we pray for wisdom for government, we pray for patience. We pray for an end to this crazy melting situation here at the moment. We pray for companies most sanitary effective in Brazil, United States, India. Well, we thank you for the riches in this country. We pray that you be generous with them. And that is your own thing. Recognizing this is a global problem. Well, we also pray in this country for our own government.
formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Tom, very much. Please keep your reading handy, because there's a lot of material, as you can see, in those verses. I've had some sleepless nights over this. So we're going to pray, and we're going to ask God to help us. Lord, we thank you so much for your word. Thank you for this great letter. And we pray again this morning that you'll speak to us, that you'll teach us what it means to be a member of your people in this great worldwide community. And help us, we pray, here in Burford Church, to be part of this great movement of believers in Jesus Christ around the world to do our part. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you're a regular here, you'll know we're doing this series on Ephesians Sunday morning, first century letter written by Paul. Paul met the risen Christ, so he was in touch with the real Jesus. Paul was writing from prison. And last week, in the first 11 verses of chapter 2, we saw how anybody can become a Christian. It's brilliant news. Tom, our vicar, took us through that, and he explained that it depends on Christ alone. Tom gave us three key phrases from the passage. 5, God made us alive with Christ. 6, God raised us up with Christ. And God seated us with Christ in the heavenly realms. And we're with Christ through faith alone. That comes through grace, and that's a gift from God. So the whole lot comes from Jesus Christ. That's why we're here today as believers in the Lord Jesus. But this morning we see that being a Christian is just more than me and Jesus. Just more than me and Jesus traveling through life. When we become Christians, we're getting caught up in something far bigger, if that is possible, of which Christ is the head, and of which we're called, in other parts of the letter, the body of Christ. We're joining a new community that was started by Jesus 2,000 years ago. We're joining a global family. We're joining a Holy Spirit movement, which is bringing all kinds of people together. And I think it's a very significant message, particularly for our world at the moment, which can feel more lonely than usual. Today, writers and philosophers write about this cosmic loneliness that there is. Or Lewis Hamilton recently talked about being lonely in the Formula One bubble. Or what about lockdown? Loneliness seems to have been forced upon us in different ways. So some mothers had to give birth to their baby without the father being allowed to be present. Or the shielded elderly, Some of them have suffered extreme loneliness. And most of us, I think, would say we've learned more about what it means to be lonely in our world. And the Bible, of course, explains the ultimate alienation and loneliness that we have on the planet. Right back there, first book of the Bible, chapter 3, we have this loneliness and alienation because we declared UDI. We wanted to run the world. We wanted to take over from God. And so this morning we're looking at what God is doing in the world. He's creating a whole new humanity where there will be no loneliness and no alienation. And these verses we're looking at are also the story of what it means to be a Christian. You could use these verses as a biography of our lives. There are three paragraphs. We'll take each paragraph at a time. The first paragraph, you could entitle Life Without God, apart from the last verse of that paragraph. The second paragraph, The Lord Made Us One of His People. And the third paragraph, The Lord is Building this New Humanity. So let's take the first paragraph, Life Without God. Paul wants us to remember what we were like before we were Christians. He tells us to remember twice. So verse 11, therefore remember that formerly you who are Gentiles. Now, Paul is particularly speaking, you may have noticed that, to Gentiles in these paragraphs. It seems that there are a lot of Gentile Christians in Ephesus. Christianity started off as a 100% Jewish movement. Jesus was a Jew. The 12 disciples were Jews. On the first day of the church, the day of Pentecost, the first 3,000 believers were Jews, as far as we know. But we're told that Jesus died for the world. God so loved the world. So that now, globally, the majority of Christians are Gentiles. Most of us here this morning are Gentiles. But Paul repeats again in verse 12, to remember our past, to remember, and he's speaking to Gentiles, remember that at that time, you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. Very bleak picture that, isn't it? That's what we were like, that's what I was like, till I was 22 and became a believer. As this verse, verse 12, William Hendrickson uses five words to describe our position: Christless, stateless, friendless, hopeless, and godless. Not a happy list. It's good to remember, isn't it? And to look back. Christless. This does not mean we were not loved by Christ. We've been told already in chapter 1 that God loved us before the creation of the world. So it's not that Christ doesn't love us before we become Christians, but we don't have Christ in our lives. We've not come to Christ as our Savior and say, Lord, I need forgiveness, I need help. We haven't bowed the knee before him as our Lord and Master. He has no influence in our lives. That's why we were Christless. But then would you remember we were stateless? Of course, not stateless in terms of the nations of this world, but excluded from citizenship. That's the phrase, excluded from God's people. We were not part of God's kingdom. There's only going to be one state standing at the end of history. All through history, empires and kingdoms have come and gone. But God's kingdom is the only one that is going to be left standing at the end of time. And then we're to remember we were friendless. This doesn't mean we didn't have any friends, but it does mean that God was not our friend. It's the phrase, foreigners to the covenants. All through the Bible, God was making covenants. The Old Testament, notice their covenants is in the plural. And these covenants that God makes with people are long-term, they're initiated by God, and they're kept by God. There's nothing to do with us, but God makes covenants with this world. And there are now billions of us around the world this morning who are in a covenant with God. Remember the Last Supper up in that upper room? Jesus picked up the cup of red wine and he said, this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. This is God's covenant with us. That's why we're now in the Israel. We're now part of the covenant. We're part of God's people. So we're no longer stateless. But we're also to remember that at that time we were hopeless because we didn't believe the promises of God. We can only have hope when we have faith in God. Now, some of us may be going through nightmares at the moment. We may be having really difficult times. It looks as if there's no future for us in where we are. But as believers, the Bible is full of promises. I will never leave you or forsake you. All things work together for good, for those who love God. Sometimes it's hard to believe that, isn't it? When you're in the middle of the crisis and you're going through the pain and everything seems dark. But these are the promises. And that's why we're never hopeless as believers. Because we trust these promises. We believe what God says. We believe when he says something, he means it. And then finally, we're godless. We're to remember that. Without God in the world. We have to say the world is not without God, because God sends his Son on everybody and God sends his rain on everybody. God is at work all over the world. We're told the planet is full of the unfailing love of God. So what is the godless person? The godless person has decided they want to run life themselves. They don't want God to run their life for them. So it's a very bleak and unsettling picture. It's a reminder that we were outsiders. We were excluded. We live in a world, because where people do feel excluded, don't they? I mean, we all feel excluded in different ways. So the Black Lives Matter movement tells us that black people feel excluded. The poor feel excluded. People feel excluded socially. People feel excluded educationally. Gays feel excluded. We all feel excluded in different ways. It's what our world is like. But the ultimate exclusion, as far as the Bible is concerned, is to be excluded from God and his people. And that's what we have to remember. That's where we were, and that's where great swathes of people right across the planet at the moment are excluded. It's a very serious and bleak picture. It's a troubling picture. But it's God's picture of our planet. Let's move on. Paragraph two. We're going to take the last verse of paragraph one. The Lord makes us one of his people, 13 to 18. We now look at the transforming power for anyone who will come to Christ. We have one of the great buts of the Bible. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. If you're using your own Bible, this is a but to underline or to highlight, because it's such a terrific contrast to that previous verse we've just been looking at, isn't it? Those dreadful five words. But now in Christ, we who were far away have been brought near. Brought near to God and brought near to his people. And that's what paragraph two is all about. How we were brought near through the blood of Christ. This is how we enter God's new humanity. Through the blood of Christ. Through his death. So this is different to any other kingdom or empire that has ever existed. The great kingdoms. And I think really even the great religions of the world have been built through conquest, war, power, domination, and sometimes even brute force. And Christianity has fallen into that as well, wrongly, over the years. But God's kingdom is truly built through God's sacrificial love when he hung in his Son on the cross. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. That's how the kingdom of God grows. That's how this new humanity grows. It happens as we believe that Jesus is our Savior and we're taken into the new humanity. This is how we're brought near to God, as it says in verse 13. Paragraph 2 focuses on Jews and Gentiles, because that was a big issue in the early church. Jews and Gentiles, as you read through the New Testament, were in tension, in conflict. They had to work out a forward pathway together. Look at the next verse, verse 14. Jesus himself is our peace, who has made the two one. That is the Jew and the Gentile. He brought them together in Christ. Jesus has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. That is almost certainly the dividing wall in the temple in Jerusalem. There was a huge wall that separated Jews from Gentiles. That was the dividing wall of hostility. And it kept them apart for centuries. But now in Christ, Jews and Gentiles were being brought together. So that there's this one new humanity. And verse 15 says his purpose was to create in himself one new humanity. How is it done? The next verse tells us, and it's all to do with the cross. To reconcile both of them, that is Jew and Gentile, to God through the cross. So the cross we're seeing this morning is the focus of unity for all Christians, Jew and Gentile, black and white, whoever we are. We're brought together at the cross. Why does the cross have the power to unite us all? Because the cross shows us our deep need of a Savior. God had to come to this world and hang there and carry our sin because we're all needy people. And so we all stand on level ground round the cross. We're all people who are broken, people who have failed, people who need forgiveness. And the cross unites us no matter what our background may be. We all need to be washed clean. And the blood of Jesus has that power to cleanse us and to make us holy. Now, we still live in a world of barriers. I mean, the cross hasn't brought unity around the world, has it? Go for a little walk around the beautiful Cotswolds. I hadn't thought about this till I was writing this sermon. But start walking across the fields and across some of the hills. There's barbed wire, hedges, wooden fences, stone walls, notices telling us to keep out. Now, there's nothing wrong in that, but they are barriers. That's the world we live in. We went for a little walk with the grandchildren over the summer, walking along a footpath, decided to have our lunch there. So we sat on the grass, probably about 5 yards from the footpath. We were halfway through lunch, and a gentleman appeared and told us to clear off, because he said it's the footpath that is the public right of way, not the grass. And it seemed clear logic to me, so we got up and we walked away. But that's the world we live in, isn't it? There are these walls of hostility all over the place. Well, Christ came to break these barriers down. And the new world that Christ is going to give us eventually, there are going to be no barbed wire, we can be sure of that. And there's not going to be any razor wire, not even to keep the wild animals in, because we're all going to be together, united in Christ. And so we have to watch for that in our little part of the global new humanity here, that we don't build barriers. We don't have any racial barriers or class barriers or gender barriers or educational barriers. That's why we must never move away from the cross. That's why we love taking the bread and the wine. That's why we love it when we have passages like this, because it keeps us close to the cross. But if you look back at verse 13, you'll see there are two ways in which Christ brings us near to God and near to his people. Yes, the blood of Christ, but look at how the verse starts. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near. See what we're being told. As Christians in Christ, and this is a big theme of this letter, we're spiritually joined to Christ, and therefore we're all joined together. We all have the same spirit. Christ is in you by his spirit. Christ is in me. And that immediately gives us a unity and a oneness and a position together. He takes us into this new humanity. So he not only died for us and his blood opens the door, but his spirit makes it a living reality. Last weekend, we celebrated our 50th wedding anniversary. Don't understand how we've ever reached 50 years, but God's done it, and he's kept us together. And we had a great time. But the family gave us a present. They joined together, and they gave us a voucher to go to one of Raymond Blanc's restaurants. And it must be very expensive because the voucher's worth a lot of money. I thought we were going to go away for a week's holiday, but no, it's for one meal. And so they paid the price for that. But also, they're going to take us in the car to the restaurant and hopefully bring us back. But that's what Christ... It's a great picture, that, of what Christ has done. He's paid the price with his blood, and now by his Spirit, he takes us into the new humanity. Third and final paragraph, and I'm going to put my foot down because time's running out. The heading for the final paragraph is the Lord at work in his new humanity. In verse 19, we're shown the consequences of all that Christ has done for us. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens. See the first picture there? There are three pictures in this paragraph. The first picture is the Lord is creating a new society. We're all fellow citizens. So in the first century, Gentiles had become fellow citizens with Jews. That was quite incredible. So why did it happen? Because they're all one in Christ. Because the blood of Christ had got them in. Same with us today. In the 21st century, all of us as Christians are fellow citizens. No matter our colour, no matter which school we went to, no matter what kind of house we live in, we're fellow citizens in this new society. Second picture, the Lord is bringing together a family. 19, members of God's household. The picture of a family is far more friendly and intimate than a citizen. That's what we're in now. Brothers and sisters is the most common word for Christians in the New Testament. So it does see us as a family. We also have one Father in heaven. And God is bringing millions of us all over the world into this glorious eternal family. Third picture, the Lord is building a temple. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. See the foundation of the temple that's being built? The apostles, the prophets, Christ. Where do we find the apostles, prophets, and Christ? In the Bible. That's why we keep looking at the Bible. This is the foundation. And here in Burford, we're part of this great global temple that's being built in the Lord. And we want to make sure we keep building on the foundation. That's why we're so pleased that Tom has come as our vicar, because he loves teaching from the Bible. It keeps the foundation firm and secure. What is the purpose of the temple? In Christ, 21, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. So we are a holy temple. That means we're separate for the Lord. We're set aside for God to do his work. This isn't your church. It's not my church. It's not the PCC's church. It's not the bishop's church. It's not Tom's church. The whole idea of us here is to be a temple in the Lord, in Christ. It's what he wants. And we want to follow him, and we want to do his will. But we must always remember, and I love this last verse, verse 22. In Christ, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. We're always going to be a building site. We're not the finished article. We're not perfect. Building sites are messy. Building sites are dirty. Building sites are difficult to live in. Building sites may be changing and altering as the building goes up. And that's what we are as the church. We'll never be the perfect church. We'll always be a building site. And God has got a lot to do in us. He's got a lot more to do in some of us than others, but he has got a lot done. I'm looking around, that's why I'm putting my head down. But we are a holy temple. We are the Lord's temple. We want in this temple reconciliation, not alienation. We want this temple to be one of unity, not division. harmony, not discord, inclusion, not exclusion, friendship, not loneliness. They're the things that matter in this temple. This is a wonderful story we're caught up in, isn't it, as Christians? There was a time when we were without God, but in Christ Jesus, we've been brought near. And now we're part of this global new humanity. And God is at work amongst us. That's great to know that. And our task is to keep building on the foundation. Let's pray. Lord, what a vision you give us here of what it means to be a Christian. Thank you for our Lord Jesus. Thank you that he's our Savior. Thank you that he's our Lord. Thank you that he's Lord of all. Thank you that he's the Savior of the world. And thank you that we're part of this great movement of believers in this huge worldwide temple. And oh, Father, we ask that you will keep us building on Christ. May he be the center of all that we do, of all that we are. May he be our first love. May we not fall into that trap that the Ephesians fell into, where they lost their first love. Please, may he be our Lord. May he be our Savior day by day. May he be the one we follow and stay close to. Thank you for this great picture you've given us today of what we were and where we are today. We give you all the praise and all the thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Alex, thank you so very much for pointing us to the Lord Jesus Christ and all that we are in him and what he is doing in and through us, uniting us and knocking down those walls of hostility. Well, our next song, which is again going to be sung by the choir and the musicians helping us, the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ our Lord. An opportunity for us to sit and to reflect, to allow these words to sink in and allow God's word to transform us. We remain seated as we hear this song for us. Well, before we close, just a couple of things to mention. First of all, that if you're happy and able, if a few people could help us move chairs, you can see from all the wires that hang around, there's some scaffolding that's in here in the week, and to help us sort out some of the lighting in here. If a few of you are able to move some chairs to there, that'd be very much appreciated. But secondly, with the ongoing clarification of government legislation, they're encouraging us not to linger after things like services. However, as I said on e-news, that doesn't mean we shouldn't be involved in fellowship. Let me encourage us to legally, but creatively, think of ways in which we can make sure that we continue to extend those bonds of friendship that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. One of the things that, as we've been thinking about already this morning, is just the cruelty of the loneliness and isolation. So let's be thinking about how we can creatively get to know one another, love one another, and support one another in these days. Well, as we close, let us say this final prayer together. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the source of all goodness and growth, pour his blessing upon all things created, and upon us, his children, that we may use them to his glory. Amen. Amen.